Hi, I'm here with Mari Winsor at her studio on Melrose in LA, and I'm going to ask her some questions that I think probably a lot of you have been wondering about for a long time. First of all, Mari.
Yes, dear.
You made Pilates really a household name. Tell me, I know you were a dancer, so I want to hear about how, what brought you to Pilates and your background in dance and...
Well, you know, it was no accident, and I wasn't solely responsible for that, you know. Romana worked with me for a long time, and she instilled in me her joy of movement and the specific technique of the work, which I hold dear to this day, and there's a few of us out there. Hi. How are you? And I can't say, okay, people say I made Pilates the household name, but it was much more than that. It was, and it wasn't just me. It was the luck of the draw. I live here in LA. I happen to work out a lot of celebrities. And usually in infomercials, they pick, you know, the Barbie doll girl that they think is going to sell product. And they happened to get, like, not a Barbie doll girl, but, you know, I was pretty enough, I guess. But I also had the chops. I had the knowledge. I had the real talent. I was a real teacher. And that doesn't often happen in infomercials. And I think that because of my honesty and my ability to teach and reach a lot of people, it all worked. And it was the right time, too. Everybody was just starting to hear a lot about Pilates, and they were interested and curious. So it was at the time when that just, you know, a little bit of push and it just peaked. And I was fortunate, I was lucky, and I feel that there were a lot of people who worked with me during that time who were brilliant, who knew what to do. I just did what I did. I didn't really go out there and market it. It was all about Guthrie Ranker and doing what they did. And I felt really fortunate to have those people behind me. That's what really did it. And the curiosity of the public and the timing of it, and the fact that I did have a lot of celebrities that I worked out because I'm here in LA. I mean, that's what happens. I think pretty much any Pilates trainer or fitness trainer that lives here for a period of time and establishes a good reputation, you're going to have some celebrities coming in and out of your studio. But thank you for that. That's a nice compliment. But really, I think Romana, on the long end of things, it's Romana who's really responsible, not me.
So when you started, I was looking at your bio, and I realized that you started Pilates and didn't maybe know about Romana at the beginning.
Oh, I did not. It's very true. I was a dancer, and I danced all over the world. I was a modern dancer. And then I became like a jazz dancer and came to Los Angeles, and I danced with Michael Jackson in Smooth Criminal, and I danced in a movie called Roadhouse that Patrick Swayze started. And I was just dancing all over the place. And I realized as I approached 40 that I can't be like doing that for that much longer because everyone else is 28 and I'm 40. So what am I going to do? My friend in New York told me about Pilates and described the equipment to me. So I found a place that had the equipment and learned what they knew, and found that what they knew sort of went against my dance training, which was very extensive. I was at the Ailey School for 3 years, and I learned from all the best teachers. And so I have that technique in my bones. And something didn't ring well. And so I decided to venture off on my own. And in 1990 this was, and then searching around for someone who could help me learn more, I had a difficult time. So I went ahead and started my studio anyway because I knew I was a people person and that would at least get me by to a certain point. And it bothered me that I didn't really know what Pilates was until I met Romana. And when I met Romana, I was so overwhelmed with her joy and her beauty and her elegance that I knew I had to glue myself to her side until I could be my own person with the work. And it takes time. I mean, it's nothing that happens overnight. As most of you know, you have to study and learn and teach. And eventually, your students become your best teachers because your creativity and your ingenuity and your memory and your willingness to learn and do it, and really your intuitiveness, I think, is probably very important, because you're able to look at a body and see what to do with it. And if you're successful with it, you go, ah, I learned something. Because we all want to be successful. We all want to help people. I mean, that's why we're doing this, right?
Mm-hmm, definitely.
Yeah. So really, I didn't meet Romana until 1993. And I got certified that same year. And I took the work back to my studio and tried to teach my teachers it. Well, that didn't work out so well, because I had a group of teachers that were originally just friends of mine, who were dancers also, and they were happy, their clients were happy. Why should they learn anymore? And I was like, okay, I get it. They all want to be actors anyway, so this isn't going to work. So it took me a long time to change, make that changeover and bring people into my studio that really wanted to be there and really wanted to teach Pilates and had some integrity.
So you were running at that point.
I was running fast is what I was doing.
You were running this studio or more than one studio at that time?
Oh, I just had the one studio.
So you were already running a studio, and I'm interested in the nuts and bolts of running a successful studio, because you've been doing it really for a very long time and very successfully.
It goes in and out and up and down,
okay.
You know,
especially
in the fitness business. No business in the fitness industry is smooth and great all the way through. Mm-hmm. You have, you know, there's Christmas when everybody's out of town. There's August when everybody goes away. I mean, you have to deal with those kinds of things. But hopefully in the months around those times when people are gone, you can build it up and get people really committed to doing the work.
Mm-hmm.
But I find that a lot of teachers, when I hear them making appointments, and I always stop them and correct them, but you cannot make the client feel as if they're accommodating your schedule.
Mm-hmm.
It's a mistake that people make. Well, you know, I have a waiting list, I'm too busy, sorry.
But right? You really are often. So
well,
you have
yeah,
to
but
you, someone...
they don't have to know it like that.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you know, the best thing to say is, you know, I would really love to work with you. You look like you'd be a great client for me to have. Right now, I just don't have another hour in the day, mm-hmm. but please let me take your number. And the minute I get a cancellation, I will give you a call, or we can make an appointment in 3 weeks or a month, something like that. When I know I do have some time, and is that what you would like to do? Put it back on them. Don't ever make them feel that they are accommodating you. We believe it or not, guys, we're in a service-oriented business.
Yeah.
We are doing a community service. We are in the business of empowerment.
Yes.
And in return, if we really do that, if we do that with honesty, integrity, it will come back to us in that way. Mm-hmm. And that's how you build a business, mm-hmm. I think.
That's true. Mm-hmm. That's one of my first impressions of you. I was a young student at Romana Studio.
You were a young student. You're still a young
well, and not student. And you walked in, yeah. and of course, I hadn't met you before, but I recognized you immediately.
Yeah.
And you walked in as though you were impressed with everyone there. And you said something, you commented on people working out. Well, who are these superstars over here? And it really felt as though you saw us, and that was really special.
Yeah,
and that's
thank
something
you.
That you carry through in everyone.
It's a nice memory to have.
It is. It really is.
You know, Romana's studio in New York was always a special place for me to walk into, because that's where I learned. That's where my eyes were open. And whenever you have a place like that, it's always so special to go back to. And I was always so grateful. And it was fun for me to come in and see other people going through the same thing that I went through. And I always wanted to comment and try to make, because I knew that the process of being certified can be a bit grueling.
Yeah.
So I wanted to come in like a little butterfly and try to make people feel good.
It speaks really to the quality that you carry through in your whole life. And I think that's a big part. I just wanted to bring it up because I think it's also a big part of how you treat your clients, how you treat your teachers, and a lot that has to do with the success of your business.
I try.
Yeah.
You know, there's always going to be one or two of those people that got to go and got to do and got to steal clients. It happens to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm certainly not immune to it. And it can be painful, but I have to tell you, people they have a choice. They can either leave you with integrity or they can leave you like a thief in the night.
Yeah.
And the ones that leave like a thief in the night, they will always be a thief, and they will never be successful in their heart.
Mm-hmm.
And when you teach Pilates, it's such a close, intimate
exchange
mm-hmm. between you and your client, that if you don't have that sense of integrity, it comes through.
Yeah.
It comes through, and people get, you know, once they get the excitement of the movement, and then they look a little bit deeper into it, and they see that there's nothing there, then they're going to move on.
Yeah.
You know, you have to have integrity.
Mm-hmm.
You really do. It's so important, and loyalty is important, too. I mean, it happens. When people want to do their own thing, it happens.
Mm-hmm.
But you can do it right, and you can do it wrong. And in your heart, you know it's right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I'm saying. Just be careful, be mindful of that, because if you don't do it right, it follows you and it will haunt you your whole career.
So it sounds like if you were to pick qualities of, say, your top teachers, if you think in your mind of the teachers who are the most successful in your studio, beyond yourself, maybe including yourself, can you name a few qualities that you recognize in them that cross all those
lines? Oh, absolutely. The number one thing is that you care about the person that's there in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
Really care.
Mm-hmm.
That you really see them. That your eyes are open to what their balances and imbalances and strengths and weaknesses are.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a movie star or a Brentwood housewife, it makes no difference. The work is the same for everyone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Truly. So that's one thing.
That's one of the main things I think is really important. And I think, let's see, what else? I think that being nice, being patient, that's a big one. I remember I had a trainer who was working with a client, and she made a mistake. And this trainer put her hand on her hip, and she said, I told you yesterday what to do, and now you can't do it. I took her over to the side, and I said, darling, we need to have a little chat. You know, you can't talk to people like that. You know, the client is always right. The client rules you. And if you let the client rule and you lend yourself over to that, you will learn.
Mm-hmm.
That's when you will learn. That's when you will see them.
Mm-hmm.
If you always feel that you have to impose your values, and, you know, the poor client that comes in, the Brentwood housewife that comes into the studio, and all of a sudden you're imposing all the names of the muscles and bones, and you know, you spend 20 minutes on footwork, it's like, what? Right? People
I just came to give a workout,
you know? I don't care where Joseph Pilates lived and died. And they don't.
That's true.
They just want to get a workout. And that information just goes over the head. We care.
We do.
And it's important to us. But what's important to the client is that they get a good workout.
Mm-hmm.
And they
feel that you see them?
And you feel that they see, and you're patient and kind, because people feel intimidated by this work, and there's nothing worse than a cranky trainer.
No kidding.
Do you know what I'm saying?
It is intimidating.
Cranky.
Look at this thing we're sitting on.
Hold on one second. I have to take this phone call.
Oh, that's the worst.
It's my doctor.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you have to pick and choose.
Truly.
You know, sometimes things happen. There is maybe a phone call that you need to take. You know, if you're... dog fell out of a car or something, you need to, you know, take care of that. But for the most part, there's always a way that you can take care of it later. You don't have to do it right then and there. The client's time, they're paying for that time. It's the most important time.
Yeah.
You have to be attentive. And I'm talking to everybody.
Yeah, for sure.
New York, California, mm-hmm. Montreal.
Doesn't matter where
it doesn't
you
matter. You have to be there for the person. What your agenda is and what your MO is not important. And they don't care. And if you try to make them care, they will run as fast as they can.
So does that speak also to, there's a lot of maybe chit-chat that can go on, that friendships that develop with clients, but
yes,
do you feel that it's important
to
not let that happen too much on your own part? And
now that's a loaded question.
Yeah.
I think that conversation is important, because guess what? Some people need conversation.
Yeah.
Some people come to you and they don't talk to anybody else the whole day. You're the only person they get to talk to. So they need you mm-hmm. on a certain level. Mm-hmm. But it's your job to bring it back mm-hmm. to the workout.
With kindness.
With kindness. You know, somebody goes, oh my God, you know, my baby and my husband went on and you're like, oh my God, I know. You know, same thing happened to Now, you know, if you do this exercise just right, it will help take away some of that stress.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so always bring it back to the workout. Mm-hmm. Don't let them, because if you let them talk the whole time, they'll be done with their workout and they'll say, well,
I
didn't get a workout.
Right.
Well, of course they didn't.
Right.
You know, but you rule your clients mm-hmm. without mm-hmm. them even realizing it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have say over what their workout's going to be, for Christ's sake. You have to pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
And listen is important. Some people need that. Mm-hmm. That's part of who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing that turns off a poor person that comes in for some workout, maybe a little conversation. Not a drink at the bar, certainly. But
they're,
you know,
trying to share with you. And
they're
you're
trying
like,
to share.
Just do it.
Yeah, yeah, right? No. Huh? It's human. It's part of life.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that shouldn't be turned on or turned off,
mm-hmm.
at, you know, because you said so, right?
Totally.
Or that, you know, they're trying. You don't want them. A lot of people that come in, and Janice Dulock gave a whole lecture on it. I loved it. But a lot of people that come in to work out, they don't really want to work out. You know what I'm saying? They really don't want to work out. They want a nice body.
Right.
Don't we all?
They just want you to do it to them.
But they want you to do it to them, and they don't really want to work out. So they're going to see if they can manipulate you into not working out.
Right.
So you have to be aware. There's so many personalities, and I love Janice Dulock's take on that. And some of you who are really interested should maybe look her up online and see all the what her case studies and stuff. It's very interesting.
Janice is, I'll just say for everyone out there, Janice Dulock is a wonderful Romanus Pilates instructor who has a Pilates for Equestrians,
right,
for Equitation
right,
program, and she's pretty awesome.
She's so awesome. She's
yeah,
a friend of mine. I just love her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I would love to talk a little bit about some of the celebrities you've worked with. Do you have any stories? And really, I want to know, are they any different, or are they just like us?
No, just kidding. No, they're. I'll tell you what, the first time I had a big celebrity come to my studio, I was nervous.
Mm-hmm.
Patrick Swayze.
Mm-hmm.
And I was a young dancer. I was still dancing a little bit, dabbling in it in my early 40s. And I danced with Patrick's sister, Bambi Swayze. And she said, you know, Patrick should do this. I'm like, yeah, right. Send him in. And she did.
Oh, my God.
I gave her a challenge, and she did. So he came in, and his body at that time, it took your breath away. And he had just done Ghost.
Oh,
so
my.
He was at the top of his game.
Yeah.
And of course, I was a fellow dancer, so I tried to erase everything else.
You're
and
like,
think,
right. Stop thinking about
I'm trying
that.
To erase everything. Oh, this is a fellow dancer. So I did it like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, for every particular client, there's some way that you can relate to them that will help them understand. Like, with, I worked out with Steven Spielberg one time, and I was a little nervous with him, too, because...
Steven Spielberg.
He's Steven Spielberg, for Christ's sake. But, you know, one day I was sitting there, and that man would not... I mean, I love him. I hope you never see this, Steven. You're a wonderful man. But he wouldn't listen, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. And to me. And so one day I said to him, so, Steven... What do you do when an actor doesn't listen to you when you give them direction on the set? And he went, oh, oh.
He knew you were talking about
him. And he listened.
Smart.
He listened. And it was great. We established something different at that point. You know, I wasn't one of those people that, Mr. Spielberg, what
he saw you in his role,
yeah.
And all of a sudden it was...
Right, yeah. It was a little different, yeah.
Put him in your shoes.
And then there was always Al Pacino. I remember one of my clients asked me to work with Al Pacino. This was early on. And I had to go to his hotel near the beach. And all the way over, I'm in my car going, it's only a man. It's only a man driving. It's only a man. Because I, you know, as being 64, Al Pacino was one of my, like, heartthrob heroes. So I'm only a man. So I get to the hotel. He says, yeah, I'm wrong. And Bobby says, come on up. So I went up to his room. And there he was standing with his fly undone. And I didn't know quite what to do. I was like,
Hi.
No, I didn't. And, you know, sometimes I start clients with a little stretch routine where they lie on the floor and I take their leg and I envision all kinds of horror. But his fly, if he doesn't have underwear on, I'm in big trouble.
I'll just have to say it at some point.
No, I did. I finally said, Al, fly. When I was stretching him, he went, oh, it was hard.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, he was an amazing, he is an amazing human being, an amazing actor, and we had a really great exchange. It was fun.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So they're really just like us. You just really have to go into it with
them. They're just like us. They bleed, they eat, they go to the bathroom.
Everything just like us.
God forbid if you turn into a celebrity, you're going to be like a crazy woman. I can tell. Just kidding. I mean, I feel sorry a lot of times for some of the bigger celebrities. When Miley Cyrus would come into the studio, mm-hmm. there'd be like 40, 50 paparazzi hiding out in the bushes waiting for her to finish
her workout. I have seen many photos of her leaving Winsor Pilates.
Hello.
Yeah.
So
sad.
We would laugh.
Would you go look out the window?
Yes.
Okay, it looks like they're
yes.
all taking
and
a
And they
break.
Were trying to hide, right?
Yeah.
Like, we see you. That was funny. I mean, there's lots of little funny things like that that happen. You laugh on a human level and you bond and mm-hmm. and you do the best you can. That's all you can do. Mm-hmm. I have to say that celebrities oftentimes have really hectic schedules.
Sure.
So they don't get to be
mm-hmm. as consistent as
your Brentwood housewife. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you take who you can when you can and how you can. That's all you can do.
Do you find that someone who's that motivated mm-hmm. in making their career happen has a better work ethic when they're working out? Or is it just... everyone's human and it depends on the person.
Miley had an amazingly strong work ethic.
Mm-hmm.
She was like, she was in it.
Yeah.
She came in every day for 4 or 5 months.
Wow.
And that body snatched. It mm-hmm. snatched right up.
Mm-hmm.
Her legs, her butt, her waist, her tummy. I was like, well, she's young. She was 19,
sure.
20.
Yeah.
A young body does that. Doesn't happen so quickly for those of us who age.
She'll find out.
Well, she may not. She's Miley Cyrus. She may stay young forever.
That's right.
No, but she was a great client and got a studio in her home mm-hmm. where I worked her out. And we had a great time. And she's on tour right now, so
Were you preparing her for a tour?
Yeah,
it was
her first move for her big change.
Wow, that's cool.
If you think about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was the first thing that she did.
It was like growing up.
Yeah, yeah, and I was so proud to be part of that process.
Yeah.
And she's delightful.
Mm-hmm.
She's warm and kind
mm-hmm.
and generous,
mm-hmm.
but don't mess with her.
Yeah.
You know.
Right.
Just saying.
That's cool. I can respect that. I want to go back to studio, the mechanics of your studio again, just a little bit, because I know there are so many instructors and studio owners out there who really need help on things like, how do I market my studio? How do I bring clients in? How do I keep my teachers motivated?
That's hard.
It's hard, right?
It's really hard. I mean, I was lucky. I feel like I was kind of born into it because mm-hmm. Of where I was, mm-hmm. location. Mm-hmm. If you have the right location with the right parking, mm-hmm. with the coffee place next door or the restaurant two doors away, and you've got all the convenient things, if you're just starting a studio and you have no clients, mm-hmm. keep it small. Mm-hmm. Romana always said keep it small. If you have no clients and you start a studio and you start with 3,000 square feet and 10 performers, you're in big trouble.
Yeah.
Unless it's in an area that you know, there's no Pilates studio there and there are affluent clients in the neighborhood. It's worth a shot. But for the most part, you want to try to keep it really small.
And then maybe move when you're overflowing.
Yes, move when you're overflowing. And I'll tell you what, the best PR is the bodies. The best PR is the bodies you make. If you focus into that person and change that body, they will tell 10 friends. Mm-hmm. 10 friends will tell 10 friends. Because there's nothing better. Oh my gosh, my waist is an inch smaller. Hello,
yeah.
I have to go to Pilates.
Yeah.
Or, oh my gosh, I can get into my jeans I couldn't get into for the last 3 years. You know what I mean? Those kinds of things are what brings you business. You can advertise all you want. Mm-hmm. You can go on TV. You can mm-hmm. talk about it. You can know.
Social media.
But if you don't change bodies,
yeah,
you won't have a business.
That's so true.
Yeah. One body at a time.
Right, right.
That's why you have to start small.
And is that a way to motivate your instructors? Like, what do you do to keep your instructors from just phoning it in?
Oh, well, they're self-motivated, those kids.
Okay. Got it. They're like, I got to make some money here.
Right. Exactly.
But do you make it so that they have to fill their own schedule? Or, like, how much are you providing clients for them?
Oh, and they people have to come keep in those? Based. People come in based on the reputation of Winsor Pilates.
Sure.
And then I divvy them out.
Okay.
That's the way it works.
Right.
And sometimes, you know, if I divvy out a client to you and they have a friend that wants to come in with the same trainer, that's great.
Okay, yeah,
you know,
you earned it.
Yeah, it's motivating, whatever. It's always up to the client, not up to the trainer. It's up to the client.
So do you just keep a list of your teachers and then every time a new person comes in, they get filled in, you know,
We go down the line. Yeah,
that's
exactly.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really nuts and bolts like that that a lot of us don't know when we move from teaching in our own little home studio to teaching in a bigger space.
Right, right, right.
You're managing people, and that's different. It's another skill.
All it is common sense.
Yeah.
If you open up your heart mm-hmm. and you're mindful mm-hmm. and considerate to everyone around you, it will come naturally mm-hmm. because there's always going to be that situation that comes up where you go, oh, I'm not ready for that one.
Yeah.
Always. And it's happened to me. It's happened to everybody.
Right.
You know, and how you react sometimes, what you have to do is you have to go, okay, I have to take my emotions out of this right now, and I have to play it business.
Mm-hmm.
It's business. It is a business.
Mm-hmm.
And when our emotions get involved in the business, sometimes we get ourselves into trouble. So as long as if you have a business and there are people that work with you, if you're considerate and kind and helpful, there's nothing worse than having a trainer come in and work in your studio and you see them from across the room and go, hey, put that headrest up. Right? There's nothing worse than that.
Feels
because
very shameful.
It's very shameful. You're embarrassed. It makes you look bad in front of your client. So I never try to demean my trainers in front of their clients. If I see something that I don't agree with, I'll pull the trainer aside and I'll say, hey, where'd you learn that one?
Mm-hmm.
I missed that workshop.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if somebody can give me a good reason why they did that for the person at that particular time, I'm all for it.
Totally.
Because it's all about being creative mm-hmm. and thinking sometimes outside the box to accommodate your client and be intuitive, right?
Truly.
And I want the people that work with me to feel creative, to feel that they're their own person, to feel that they've made some great decisions and that they're growing. I want them to be empowered too, because if they're not empowered, then the client doesn't feel right, and then they all want to work out with me. And I can't do that.
And you have to be really nice and say, in 6 weeks, I have an opening in my schedule.
No, but I don't do it.
Right.
I won't do it. Right. I won't do it. So, you know, you have to be gracious and kind. Mm-hmm. And if something really bothers you, never talk about it in front of the client.
Truly.
No matter what it is, you know?
Do you have difficulty trying to keep clients from only wanting to come to you, or trying to get them to work with more than one instructor? Because I know that can be a problem when a person only works with one teacher.
It can be a problem, but how do you avoid it?
Yeah.
Because it's the client's game. It's not your game. It's the client's game. I know there are a few studios I've heard of that make the client rotate, and it's okay. It works out okay, but the clients really don't dig it that much. Mm-hmm. They'd rather be with one person that they can relate to. They know what they're going to get when they come in, and that's important to people, to have consistency.
Sure.
Is really important to people. So, and of course we always say, well, it's about the work, but you know, at the end of the day, it's about the person who's telling you about it too, and how they relate to you. And if you establish a good relationship with someone, I'm not going to go, okay, tomorrow you're working out with Patty. You can't work out with her anymore. You know what I mean? I'm not going to do that.
That's not going to be nice.
Not good for business.
So, Mari, I wanted to bring up something that I found out about recently, and it's that you're ill.
I am ill.
Yeah.
I am very ill. I'm surprised I'm this ill. I had no idea. Mm-hmm. I was trying to find out why my speech was slurred and why I had like drool coming out the side of my mouth and why my arm doesn't work. And I was told by many doctors it was just nerve damage and the speech was old age. And I looked further into it, and at the beginning of the summer, I was diagnosed with ALS, and it's certainly been an interesting journey for me, teaching and trying to keep my energy and my faith intact, and it's challenging. But I'll tell you what, I have a whole slew of people. Can we bring them out?
Yes.
Can we go get them? My beautiful people.
We're going to bring a few people out here. We're going to cut for just a moment and bring them.
Okay, yeah. These are the people that keep me going. They give me strength and a reason to be here and want to be here and fight this horrible disease. If it weren't for each and every one of these wonderful people, I feel really blessed to have the opportunities that I've had and to have the people around me that I have around me, because I know I'm going to be okay. And so everybody, I challenge all of you.
We're all going to ice bucket right now.
Can I pour the water?
Yes.
All right.
Thank you, Mari.
Ciao for now.